Thanks, Adam. Verne 2.0. I need to think about that. So this talk is, I modified the title slightly to clarify it. It's about writing binary plugins for Bro. And I figured it's like early afternoon of the first day, so it's time for some C++ code. So this is actually a slide I often use for introducing Bro, and it's a slight twist on the standard architecture slide out of the original paper. This one kind of emphasizes Bro as a platform. So it gives you this programming language, it gives you a standard library, and then on top of that, you can kind of put in your own scripts. You can program the system for the specific kinds of analysis that you want to do. So this is focusing on extensibility, however, at the script layer. So this talk is actually about this layer down here because we have extensibility there too. And if you've ever looked at the code in Bro, you will see that there are a bunch of pretty self-contained units in there. So there are protocol parsers, there are file parsers, there are log writers, like the thing producing the ASCII logs or exporting into other destinations. They're input readers, reading data from files into tables. They're also packet sources. By default, that's PCAP, but you can also interface this to other stuff. I think it was Bro 2.4, where we started kind of changing the infrastructure internally to make these components, as I call them, the protocol parsers, the file parsers, packet sources, these components, more independent of the core itself, meaning you can now write them externally in the form of a binary plugin. And the plugin really is kind of, it's essentially a shared library at that point where it's a container containing code for implementing a log writer, for example, or implementing your custom protocol analyzer, implementing your custom file parser. And this talk is about showing how that actually works. I mean, how do you create such a plugin, such a shared library, which you can then, as Bro starts up, load into the system dynamically without ever needing to touch any line of code in Bro itself. Maybe just for illustration, so there are a bunch of plugins already. If you go to GitHub and search for them, you find plugins for Kafka, AFPacket, HTTP2, LDAP, Community, PostgreSQL. These are all like plugins providing different kinds of components. Some of them are packet sources, NetMap, for example. Some of them are new protocol parsers. So people have been starting to write these, and I think it's pretty successful, this notion of detaching new core functionality from the system itself. So let's look at what is the plugin. So in the most simple sense, it's essentially directory on disk, which is here base, and there's a certain number of expected pieces in this directory. So the most important one is actually just the marker file, Bro plugin, which tells Bro, okay, this directory contains a Bro plugin. Then there's a shared library, which has the main functionality, and then you can ship additional Bro scripts with your plugin, because usually it's not just the binary part you want, but there's some like script level logic you want to put in place as well. And this scripts directory gets automatically added to Bro path, so it becomes available just for normal load directives in Bro script land. To create such a plugin, this structure, requires quite a bit of boilerplate code, essentially, something which pretty much every plugin will need. And we created a script for this, which ships with Bro in a somewhat hidden place. So it's in source Bro orgs plugin support. It's called init plugin. And you give it a directory name. You give it a namespace to, for your plugin. Each plugin has kind of the name consists of a namespace plus like your local name for it. And then it creates a bunch of files in this directory. So this is where I'm going to switch to a demo to actually show this. Let's see if this works. So on my screen, I see a shell. Oh, actually, this might be Duels monitors this part. Just a sec. Better. Okay. So I hope actually. So this is like in best Bro tradition, an interactive session, and I'm hoping that I can make this large enough that you guys can actually see it. How's that? Good? Okay, so kind of, let me clear the screen. There's my, so kind of coincidentally, I have this essentially this command line I just showed you on the slide already in my shell history. I'm using the full path. I'm using like a separate bro installation I just put into bro demo, and this is the full path to the init plugin script. I'll just put it into a directory demo plugin. I put it into my GitHub name, GitHub username as the namespace, and I call my plugin demo. So if I run this, there's a bunch of stuff it puts in place. I have a new directory now. And actually, didn't go in there, with a bunch of files. And I'm going to talk a bit more about these files in a minute. But first of all, I just want to show that basically what I got here is an empty plugin. So you can, this builds, this installs, it loads into Bro, it just does nothing. Let me show you that. So I can configure. There's a configure script coming with it. And after that, I can compile it. And now I have a plugin which is actually built in this build directory here. Before I show how to install that, let me show you this command line bro-dash capital N. I don't know if people have seen this one. Basically shows you that lets Bro print out all the plugins it knows about. And by default, that is actually a bunch of stuff, because everything in Bro, like all these components in Bro, the protocol parsers, the file parsers, are internally plugins. So you get a bunch of stuff, actually, and you see they're all marked as built-in, which means these are not shared libraries. They are built right into the Bro core. But internally, they're still structured as plugins. So what's important for us, though, is basically all these plugins you see here, they're all like core Bro ones, as you see at the name prefix. So if I do make install in my new plugin directory, and rerun this, then suddenly, where's my mouse? So at the very bottom, I lost my mouse, there it is. At the very bottom, you see a new plugin. This is the one we just created. We just compiled, installed, and Bro is now loading it. It doesn't look very fancy. I mean, there's some insert description in there, so we need to kind of modify this a bit. The actual source code is in the source directory, and there's a plugin CC, which is kind of the top-level plugin configuration file, and you see this description here. Let's put in something nicer there. Recompile this. And I do this bro-dash. And again, so now it's our BroCon 2018 plugin. OK, so we have a plugin. It is empty. As you can see, if I do two ends, basically all of these plugins in this output, they show you what they come with. And for all of these built-in plugins, there are file analyzers. They contain events, types, functions, so all kinds of stuff. For ours down there, at the very bottom, it's empty. So let's change that. And one of the easiest things to do is actually have one of these plugins provide a new built-in function for Bro. So some stuff you want to do in scriptland, but which is hard to express in scriptland, it's better to do in C, C++. And you can do this pretty easily by editing this file the skeleton puts in place, which is a BIF file. So BIF is Bro's extension for like a special kind of C++ files. It's for creating built-in script interpreter elements. And I'm going to do much into how this works. And generally in this presentation, I will be a bit hand-wavy on actually to do this, like write the C++ code to tell Bro stuff. I will show more how to operate with the plugin infrastructure. But I have a very simple BIF function prepared. And I'll just cat this into this demo file. So if you look at this now, so this is the function we are going to put into our plugin. I stole that right out of the Bro documentation. It's a very simple ROT13 encryption function, which takes a string, returns a string with, well, all the characters rotated. And it's almost C++, except for these like magic BIFCL things here. So just ignore the details. So basically, it's pretty straightforward once you kind of understand how to write these functions. I compile this. Put that in place. I do my double N. And you see now our plugin has a function. Well, let's call that function. So I said plugins can come with scripts. So normally you would put them into the scripts directory, but you go kind of down two layers, including the plugin name in there. So that is, which gives you a nice load command later. We'll see that. And I put it basically in this entry point for loading here, the underscore load scripts. And let me just do pro init. And I just call my new function. So this is a standard pro script, procon 2018. Does that look right? I think so. So we install this again. So we modified a file, which is part of our plugin, so we need to install it again. I run bro now, and I tell it to load the script, module, to be precise, that we just created. So it's in this namespace. And it executes this print statement here. And I guess you have to believe me that that is Brocon 2018 rotated. So this is actually a very straightforward way, once you have kind of a bit of a grasp of the C++ level for actually implementing this code, this is a pretty straightforward way to add new built-in functions to Bro. And that is for this stuff. For example, if you want to interface to an external library, right? So you need a little bit of, you need some functions to call to get into that external library. This is how you would do it. You would write a plugin for it. Gets you new functions, you can use them from scriptland at that point. Let me show you one more thing here, and that is where this actually gets installed. So make install puts this into lib bro plugins. So there, that is the default path bro searches plugins in, and you see the plugin there, and have a look in there. Let me do this differently. So basically, you see the three things I showed you earlier on the slide. So this is the plugin. So it gets installed as that. Let's get a bit more advanced. So I thought, what is kind of a more of a real plugin one would want to write, something simple to show. And I figured I'll do a very simple file analyzer. I'm not going to actually parse any file formats. What I'm going to do is I write a file analyzer that takes the first few bytes out of every file it gets to process and generates an event for that, passing those bytes to scriptland. So you get the beginning of the file in scriptland. Let me define that event. So that's another I think I have it in code again. Oh, no, I have it. Sorry. I have some magic things to copy. It's easier. So I just leave this old stuff in there, added at the top. Oops, that's the wrong one. Wrong one. I wanted to copy that. So I declared this new event I want to generate. So my file analyzer is going to trigger this event every time it gets a file to process, and it's going to return, I do 16 bytes of the beginning of the file. So let's put the actual code in place for that. So this is a bit more code, because we need to implement some C++ functions, but it's not really, I think I just made a mistake. I think I just killed one of my files. Yep. Let me show what's left. So this is the CC file, but I think I just killed my H file. Yeah. Now the question is if I have a copy. Aha. Thanks. That's the problem with the live demos, right? So I'm going to. I still need the CC file. Okay, let's see what got. So there might be like the last edit missing from this file because it's one of the backup files, but we'll see. So this is the .h file. So back to where we were. So basically what I'm going to do, what I'm doing here is I'm implementing a file analyzer. Again, and this is where the part where I'm a bit of hand wavy because, well, you have to kind of follow the API for file analyzers here, which takes a little bit of like familiarity with that. You would probably look at an existing file analyzer to do that. But we need one method to instantiate one. We need one, and this is the main one actually to, as data comes in, to process this data and does something with it. And basically down here, I have a little buffer where we store the first 16 bytes. And I believe I know what my last change was. I think I took this out. So 16 bytes, and that's what we're going to put that in. So if I look into the CC file, there's the constructor. Actually, it's not true. That was not my last change. Sorry. So the CC file is basically, this is the deliver stream function which gets the data. So every time, so this is incremental processing. Every time there's a new piece to this file, it goes into this deliver stream function. And essentially, we append it to the data we have already buffered until we have 16 bytes. And I think we can skip the rest. So this is the logic for raising the event. And one at the end of the file, if we have not seen 16 bytes yet, we want to still pass on whatever we got so far. So this is, again, it's not super difficult. If you're not familiar with the code, you will need to kind of look around a little bit. So let's see if this compiles. It does, good. Let's see if it works. So if I do this again, actually I can give this NN just my plugin name so that we don't see all the output again. I forgot one piece. Because we compiled essentially a file analyzer, but we didn't tell our plugin about it yet. So what we need to do is create a component to reuse the terminology. And for this, I have this little code here. So basically, this hooks this new file analyzer into the plugin as this is one component I provide. And you could add multiple components here. You could put in a log writer if you wanted, or a protocol parser here. And actually, there was one other piece, which is why maybe the compilation just works so nicely. I didn't actually tell it to compile this new file. So that's CMake. Basically, there's a new CC file to compile with this plugin. Let's see what happens now. Okay, now I'm getting the what I was afraid of. But this is something else. This is a copy-paste thing. I think that was my Mac turning those into. Okay, that's better, but not good enough. And that is because I now need to include this thing here. All right, that's it. All right, we got a file analyzer. Our plugin now has a new file analyzer, and it generates an event, my file event. So let's do something with this, and I think for that I have another. So make sure that it actually works. I believe this is the piece I want. Yeah. So I'm adding something to this script I already have, just so that it gets loaded if I start it up. So what I added is like these down here. Let's look at that. So at bro-init time, we are actually activating this file analyzer, which we just created. This is now, in some sense, like any other file analyzer. It's still at script land. You need to tell bro when to actually use this specific file analyzers. And what I'm doing here is basically I tell bro, OK, every time like any of your protocols sees a file of MIME type text plain, please attach this new file analyzer of mine. So then I'm implementing this event here, which is the one I just created. And I'm just going to print out the data and the file ID as it comes in. Yes, so let's see. So I need to install this again, change the script. And now I need to give it a trace so that we actually see something. And I have like a trace where we just recorded like traffic to bro.org. And I tell it to load my script module coming with the plugin. So, and you see the output. So basically, there are a bunch of files in there. And for each file, my script just executed and prints these first 16 bytes of the file's content. So this is like text plain files transferred over HTTP, first 16 bytes. If this is useful or not, I don't know. I leave that to others. But it's basically, I think what I wanted to show is that it's, in the end, it's not that much code, you need to actually put into your plugin to write a file analyzer. Normally, you would like, if you want to parse a file format now, for example, you would start parsing it from this deliver stream method onwards, right? And that could be Winpack at that point. So basically, whatever like infrastructure you want to use, or tools you want to use at that point, you would plug it in there. Or we have like these built-in hash analyzers. So they just take the payload and hash it as it comes in, and then at the end, produce the hash value. Let me see on time-wise. So for those of you who are actually going to write plugins, I wanted to just give a few quick pointers on some debugging helpers. If your plugin is not doing what it's supposed to do and you want to understand it better. So one thing, I have compiled this bro in a debug version. So when I compiled bro, I did enable debug. And that means the plugin automatically is also compiled as a debug version. That means I can give it the dash B, capital B option to activate debug output. And that is something for those who have ever worked on the bro code. So there are a bunch of debug streams for different areas of the code, and you can kind of selectively activate that to see what's going on. So and if I just run it like this with plugins, this is a, I need to give it something. So you basically, you see in this debug log, which you get then, how the plugin system internally operates. And the very first line you see is that it actually, well, it just found my plugin. So first thing, if your plugin is not showing up, is seeing if this log actually loads it. And then you see all the built-in plugins. And actually, at the very bottom, you see more about your plugin, the one we built here, and how internally like the various pieces get loaded and pulled in. For the file analysis specifically, you can add the file analysis debug stream. Now I need to give it the trace again. And if I look, so same output as before, but if I look in debug log, you actually see now the data going into the file analyzer. This is normal bro debugging infrastructure, which is kind of handy for debugging your own file analyzers in this case, or you get the same for protocol analyzers. You can also create your own debug stream. I'm going to skip that, but basically for your plugin, you can create one of these streams and print specifically to that if you want to record what your plugin is doing. Final piece for debugging, so you can, if you don't want to do these make installs all the time, so you just keep changing code locally, you can set bro plugin path to the build directory. And if you then run bro, how can I show this? Plugins. So I set basically point go directly to the plugin directory instead of doing make installs. And have a look at debug.log. You see in the first line that it actually now found it locally. It's not pulling in the globally installed plugin anymore. And this works because if you look at the build file, how it comes essentially out of the CMake setup, you see all the pieces in there. There's the bro plugin in there. There's the lib in there, which contains the shared library, and there's the scripts in there. So this CMake skeleton, which gets put in place, basically sets things up so that the build directory itself is a plugin, the one you're just developing. So it's pretty convenient for iterating. The last piece I want to show you is tests. Always important if you write a new plugin to add tests, right? We all know that. And therefore, there is actually some starting point for that in place as well. It's using the normal bro testing tool, btest. If you're not familiar with that, it's a pretty simple tool which essentially runs command lines, checks the output code if it's successful or not, and then looks at the output of that command to compare it against the previously established baseline. So if you have some output which your feature or your plugin in this case should normally produce, you would record that baseline, and then as you go forward, you can compare during regression testing the output your plugin currently produces against that baseline. That's what btest is doing, and there's one test automatically put in place through this in its plugin script, which is just a show plugin. And actually, let me show you that first. So this is automatically put in place. It's kind of the most simple btest you can think of. It's just running pretty much exactly the command line I was just showing you as a test, and it's recording the output. And then it's comparing that output against the baseline. Now, I just ran btest, and you see the output here, which is what we just saw in the command line as well. But we don't have a baseline yet, so we need to establish this baseline. Let's btest you. And from that point on, this will work. Let's do one more test, and I prepared one. Where are we? Just call it event.bro. Basically, let's write a test for this event we just created. So, and I'm again just using essentially the command line I just showed you. I just need to kind of point it to the right. Not good. I just need to point it to the right location for the traces. So it's running on this bro.org in the same way. I need to create this traces directory, because the skeleton doesn't put that in place, but I can copy my trace in there. So I'm going to run my tests. So the first one passes just fine. However, for the second one, you see the output we saw on the command line earlier. Well, that's our baseline. So again, we don't have a baseline yet, which is why it's failing. Creating the baseline. And those, by the way, they go into baseline. So you just see them there. And now my b-test, I have two tests now, and both hopefully should be succeeding. OK, cool. So I got my plugin. I got unit tests for it, or regression tests. At this point, maybe we are ready to distribute our plugin, right? So we want to share it with other people. There are essentially three ways of doing this. One is you could just distribute the source, right? I mean, just basically the thing we are just building at a skeleton. And this init plugin script actually puts a Git repository in place for that already. So what I'm having here right in my current working directory is a Git directory. And you see that basically my modifications aren't recorded in the index yet, but the original skeleton was already put into the Git index. It's not committed yet. And maybe this is a good time to say that this init plugin script I'm using is actually a slightly updated version of what's in bro currently. This will, I think, go into bro 2.6 still. So I did a few tweaks, and putting actually a Git repository in place right there is one of those tweaks. So we'll need to get that updated version. There's actually a pull request open for that. So let's kind of finish this up. So I want to commit this all. We have a few more files here. To add those in source. Oh, I'm in the wrong. Okay, I can commit this. Need to set my email address. Okay, commit. Okay. So basically, I could push this to GitHub now, or I can just start the source or whatever. So this is one way to distribute your plugin as source. The second way, which is at this point I would say almost a legacy version, is as binary, because this skeleton puts into the build directory actually a binary version of your plugin. So there's this tar file down there, which gets automatically built. And if I look in there, you see that are the files making up my plugin in the right namespace. So hard to see my mouse on this background. So you see the shared library, you see the scripts we created, and some meta files. So this, I can give somebody this tar file, and if they untar this right into their bro plugin path, that works, assuming it's the same architecture. So of course, because it's a binary plugin. So that's the second way to distribute it. However, the much better way to do all this, to distribute your bro plugins, is creating a bro package. So that is the bro package manager can deal with package with plugins in the sense that you give it the source. The bro package contains the source to your plugin, and the bro package manager will build the plugin as the package gets installed. So, and that is, with the skeleton in place, actually pretty straightforward. So we need to make sure everything is in Git. So we are committed. Let me remove the plugin which I installed manually before. That is in libpro plugins, so just so that we are not confusing which version we are using. So if I do bro-n, see there's no custom plugin in there. What I can do now is bro package, I have that pre-installed. Bro package, all it does essentially is to take a Git repository which has the right structure for a bro package and install it. So, and this could be remote, like on your GitHub, or it can be local, as in this case. So I'm running just out of the current directory. So it finds this demo plugin, the current directory, asks me if I really want to install it. And now it goes ahead actually building it. Takes a little bit. And once it has built it, it will run our tests. Yay, they passed. It will install the plugin. Takes a little moment. And at this point, bro package should show our plugin as an installed package. If I now run bro, and I run it again, I guess, on the trace maybe. And so for the bro package manager, I need to load local.bro, because that is where the, for those who have been using the package manager, this is the one bro script file you edit to pull in the packages.bro so that the bro package manager can activate the packages. So I'm loading the local.bro, and there we go. So essentially, if you recall what I did here, so I totally removed the custom installation. I just from the current directory did bro-pkg install dot, and it's the same as if it would have been coming from GitHub from somebody else's plugin repository. So and it's right there. It's compiled, tested, installed. Yeah, so that concludes my demo. Let me go back to my slides. So I think I probably should be wrapping up. So I'm going to skip one part which I didn't really want to go into much anyway. So I already said that it was a bit hand-wavy on actually how to actually write these components, right? And that the reason for that is pretty simple. I would need to explain in more detail how these APIs work. And this is, for example, the file analyzer API. So we implemented this deliver stream, and we implemented the done method in our example. You have some more methods there, and basically you need to understand how to use these methods. And again, you would probably just look at an existing file analyzer to do that. And for all these other components, the protocol analyzers, there's a similar API. So you always, you kind of need to look at, okay, what are the API methods for the specific component I want to implement, which of them do I need, and then what logic to put in there. So there's the protocol analyzer API, there's the packet source API, if you want to Telbro a new way of getting to packets. NetMap, for example, is implemented like this, or AFPacket. The LogWriter API, if you want to write custom, if you write browse logs to a custom destination, I would say, so you would hook into this, implement the right methods here. There's log rotation in there, which you can just skip if you don't need it. So there's a few details to this. Input reader, and that's pretty much it. So a couple notes for, well, I guess the advanced plugin writer. I know this was probably already quite advanced for people not familiar with the code. But if you want to go even into a bit more detail, so one thing I wanted to mention at least is that a plugin, so it's a shared library on disk, gets loaded at Bro startup. It also needs to be activated for Bro to actually use it. And by default, and that's what we did the whole time, that just happens. So there's nothing to do, actually. If you're familiar with Bro's bare mode, this is this mode where it doesn't load any of the default scripts, and you kind of pick and choose exactly what you want. In bare mode, this behaves differently, and you see the details here. Basically, it does not activate the plugin by default. It will find it, but not activate it, and then you can manually activate the plugin as you need it. And that is sometimes important if you want to kind of do ordering things correctly, or if you just kind of want to have this totally minimal Bro setup. Back to the Bro script. So earlier I showed you, like in the Bro structure overview, there's just the scripts directory. So it's a bit more nuanced in there, inside the scripts directory. There's essentially one part of this directory which gets loaded immediately the moment Bro activates that plugin. And this is this first load here, and this is not what we used in the demo. So this one, as if you remember in the demo, I was always putting the plugin module name on the command line. And in that case, the load at the bottom of the slide gets loaded. So basically at the bottom, that is what you load explicitly. The load at the beginning is what always gets loaded. Again, sometimes important for ordering issues, or generally if you want to have some stuff always available the moment your plugin gets loaded. And then there's even the preload for weird corner cases where you need to define types for your new BIF elements before anything else happens. If you want to get really fancy, there's actually one thing the plugins can do I haven't talked about. You can hook into the script interpreter. So you can actually filter function calls, for example, if you want. Or you can kind of do something every time Bro drains its event queue. Every time network time internally, Bro's notion of time gets updated, you can do something. There's some applications for this. For those who remember the Spicy project I demoed a few years ago, there's actually in that same project we also have a prototype of a Bro script compiler, and that was implemented as a plugin through this mechanism. So you actually get to get deep into the Bro script interpreter from a plugin through this mechanism. So that pretty much concludes it. So if you want to learn more about writing plugins, so actually much of what I've been talking about is actually in Bro documentation, believe it or not, except for the file analyzer part. So but basically creating the skeleton, putting this BIF function in there, I believe writing tests and stuff is actually on this page. Again, the one missing piece is actually putting a file analyzer in there. So you can kind of follow that in the documentation. The Bro Package Manager documentation has some more information on turning your Bro plugin into a Bro package. Then again, it's usually most helpful to actually just look at existing plugins. So there are two sources for that. One is if you go to packages.bro.org, which is like the visual interface to the Bro Package Manager's repository, and you filter for Bro plugin, you see a bunch of plugins other people have written. So that's starting points. And then, as I was showing you, all these built-in plugins, right? If Bro-N prints out all stuff. So internally, if you look at the Bro code, again, it's really many of these components are just structured as any other plugin, just that they are, with an additional CMake magic, are statically built in. But that is a place to go and see how to write a plugin. And then finally, the development mailing list is the right place to ask questions. And there are a bunch of people there pretty familiar with writing plugins at this point, also packages and the combination of the two. So just don't be shy. Just send an email there. It's probably better for the dev mailing list than the normal Bro mailing list, at least if it's going into internals. Yeah, that was pretty much it. Thank you very much.